on the Philippe Matthews Show. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. We've got him back for our fourth installment. I'm a little sad because it's the last one, but guess what? We've got some surprises for you guys. So don't get upset because this is not the end. It's just the beginning. Richard Haasnoot is back with me. He's an innovation expert and president of Innovate to Grow, a leading front-end innovation consulting company, and he's also the president of Blue Sage Creative, which is a highly innovative, rapidly growing, client-focused graphic design company. Catch show number two, or episode number three. He talked extensively about Blue Sage Creative and the business model of that. It was amazing. You do not want to miss that. If you are trying to build a business, run a business, create something from nothing, that's the episode you need to watch. He's also the author, as you know, of Proven Practical Innovation That Delivers Results. And this has been the Mastermind of Innovation series. And there he is a few days before New Year's, ladies and gentlemen, Richard Haasnoot. How are you, buddy?
Philippe, great to be with you. It's, I think, good timing for all of this. And look forward to our conversation today.
It couldn't be a better time. I mean, you know, when we started talking about this and noodling the idea about a month or so before we got our calendar together, I said, this is the end of the year. It's starting a new journey, a new beginning for the new year. What better guy to have on than the guru himself of innovation? And I have to admit, you have shocked me. You know, that's kind of like my moniker, shock. You know, you have shocked me. I am so, you gave me more than what I had anticipated. I really thought this was going to be more about how to innovate and think for business. And you know, it's been a little bit of that, but this is something that is so much bigger that it was almost overwhelming. And I think you want to kind of talk about that a little bit today, because the innovation that you teach applies literally to every aspect of one's life, not just in business. Now, you want to, this particular episode, we're going to be talking about innovation and job seeking. I never even heard of such a thing.
Yeah, I am. And, but just a note before I talk about that, I want to kind of close out the previous series that we were doing. Since we were on the last episode, I was recruited and hired by Emory Riddle Aeronautical University, an absolutely a wonderful institution. And they recruited me to teach an entrepreneurship class. And in the course of doing that, Philippe, I've been reading all the best-selling books on entrepreneurship. And the thing, I've always considered innovation and entrepreneurship as like brother and sister. I mean, they have to be closely connected to make all this work. And,
sure.
And I was shocked in the best-selling books, 250 plus pages long, that each of them had one page or less about what it takes to develop the big idea that you want to move forward. One book just said, think big. And I said, better than thinking small, I guess. Now, what's the big idea look like? And they don't tell you. And the other book just said, hey, brainstorm. Well, you and I have already talked that the quantum idea generation generates at least 12 times more ideas than brainstorming. So I knew that was a non-starter from the beginning.
Sure.
Here's what I want your listeners to kind of plug into. If there's entrepreneurs or entrepreneur wannabes out there that are trying to read books on entrepreneurship and what to do, there's a lot of good in those books, and I'm not trying to take away from that. But if you don't start in the very beginning with big, high quality ideas, and you know how to define what a big quality idea is and how to produce it, mm-hmm. then the rest of the stuff really does not matter, because you can have a not so good idea and all the rest of your execution can be good. So you can do the wrong thing the right way. And guess what? That 75% failure rate, it's going to rise up and bite you in the you know what.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So what I urge your listeners to do, if they're interested in entrepreneurship and being an entrepreneur, that they kind of marry that up with the sort of the Innovation Best Practices podcast that I have, that's available on iTunes or at i2ge.com/podcast, and do both of them together, because I think then you're going to be ahead of other people that are just reading about how to be an entrepreneur. End of sermon.
Well, so, you know, I have had, as you know, a lot of entrepreneurs on the show, a lot of experts, and from different fields, of business. And it's fascinating because, the whole entrepreneur thing is almost like, you know, a nomad's journey. You know, just go out there, you know, jump, earn your wings on the way down. And, you know, hopefully you'll fall into something, you'll be able to fly and soar before you go splat. I can't tell you how many times I have started, fail, and I've heard so many stories of people right now that are just struggling so greatly just to keep the dream alive. And they just don't have, they're buying all the books, they're going to the seminars, they're buying the tapes and the seminar, all of these things, nothing's working. And when I found this, it was like an OMG moment. It was like, wait a minute, this is very simple, but and you use the term practical, but it's very, very powerful because it works. Now, I'm not a scholar, so I don't know why it works, but I know that it works. So, you know, as we're talking about this overview, especially as we're talking about entrepreneurship, and we're going to get into the job thing too as well. And that's the other thing. This works in every aspect of one's life. You would think that when you talk about innovation, it's just going to be about business and creating big ideas for a business. No. I apply these principles to my workouts. I apply them to my nutrition. I apply them to my relationship. I apply these principles to every aspect of my life. I just went on a tangent because it's just exciting to me. But please give us some information about why do you think that with all of these great business minds out here, you buy the top best-selling entrepreneur books and there's nothing in there?
Yeah, I still haven't figured out why, because it's not like what I'm talking about here is a deep hidden secret back in a cave, because I've mentioned in all the...
But don't you think it is, though, in a sense, Richard? Because you got, here's the rub. You were in the hierarchy of business. You were the guy who thought up and helped businesses think up the multi-million billion-dollar ideas. Now, yeah, that's your regular life every day. So, yeah, it might be normal to you. But, it might be analogous to someone, hey, you look like you've lost weight. Oh, no, I really haven't. But, it's like, well, yes, you have, because you do this every day for 40 years. So it's normal to you. This stuff ain't normal for the regular Joe Blow. Trust me on that. And I think you are going to be, you're going to have another wave. You know, you already had your wave. You already had your success in business. But I think you're going to be like a true czar, a true guru of business, because the moment this is matched with entrepreneurship, with a proven practical innovation that delivers, the person becomes unstoppable.
Philippe, you're exactly right. And I'm excited by this. And there's a couple of words that you and I both use about this. It's proven, absolutely. The proof behind what we're talking about here is impeccable. Practical, you don't need a PhD, you don't need a college degree to do all this sort of stuff. It passes the common sense test.
Sure.
It does. I mean, when you tell people, hey, if you bring a very diverse group of people together, you're going to get more ideas than if you do it by yourself. Yeah. That's probably right. It is right.
I would have thunk it, yeah.
if you bring into a creative session all kinds of stimulus about how other people are doing it, what's happening in the broader world, that people will think of more ideas than if they didn't have the stimulus. Yeah, that'll work. And all of this. So it's, sure. But you're right. You don't need to take, 20 pages of notes on all this. And as you and I are trying to do here is we're trying to bring these tools to a much broader audience. And I'm deeply grateful for the opportunity to work with you in these interviews because, for example, I mean, my proven, my innovation best practices podcasts are free. The app for the iPhone and the Android is free. Next week, I'm going to video cast versions. They are free. What I'm trying to do is get, you know, put into the hands. In my view, the world has a lot of problems, a lot of opportunities. To do that, they need some tools to kind of solve the problems and optimize the opportunities. And these are the tools to do it. So let's talk a little bit about what you started talking about, which is how can you use innovation best practices to essentially innovate your life? And I want to talk about how you can do that with, you can do it, as you've mentioned, a whole bunch of things. But I want to talk about something that, an example that is important in many people's lives, and that is finding a job. Talk about this in the context of either you've lost a job and need to find a new one, or you're unhappy in your current job and want to find a new one. In either case, you want to find a new job. What I'm going to do here is kind of go down step by step in the innovation process and just kind of do a side-by-side comparison for your listeners to see how they're different. Most people, upon finding themselves wanting a job or needing a job, will do the following. They will say, I'm an accountant, and I want to go find a job with another accounting company, hopefully a better accounting company than I either have now or had. And so they embark and they immediately jump in and they start looking at job posting boards, Craigslist, wherever it is, and they go looking for another accounting job. Let me now put out what the beginning looks like for somebody using innovation best practices. Somebody using innovation best practices says, you know, before I jump into all the job posting boards and all that, I probably want to create a vision of what success looks like in finding a new job. What would that be? What is, and you can ask the question in a number of different ways. One of them can be, hey, what is the job that I've always kind of wished I could do? Okay, put that on the list. What is a job that really optimizes my strengths? And this is one of the things, Philippe, that is critically important, because once you start opening yourself up to broader possibilities, you find some keys to unlock possibilities you never saw when you just went, okay, I'm an accountant, I'm going to find another accounting job.
Sure.
Here's what happens when you decide, geez, I wonder what kind of jobs could really leverage my strengths. And you go, and there's all kinds of ways that you can evaluate your strengths. There's free online things. You can get friends to help you and all that sort of stuff. But when you come up with a list of strengths as an accountant, for example, one of those things is I'm very good with numbers and data. Well, what? How many jobs out there could use that strength? Is it just the accounting profession? Not only no, but heck no. In today's data-driven world, someone who is comfortable with, proficient with complex data that needs to be related to other complex data, organized and made sense of, meet government regulations, whatever it is, you go from one job to 1,000 jobs when you just do this process of saying, what are my strengths and what do I want to do? So you, if you start using innovation best practices, step one is create a vision of what success looks like. I want to use a job that leverages my strengths. Why is that pretty good sense? Well, there's a whole bunch of research that does the following, that shows that those people that have a certain level of match between their strengths and the job and the most important job requirements, these are the most successful career people out there. Does that pass the common sense test? Yeah, if I match up my strengths with the needed capabilities for a job, am I going to be more successful? Of course you are.
Of course you are.
But what you do is you move from thinking of yourself as an accountant to thinking of yourself from a strengths perspective, and all of a sudden major opportunities open up. Now, the last part of this in step one, besides vision of success, is then defining what is the strategy to accomplish that. And in the strategy, you're going to identify the sort of capabilities and resources you need to achieve that vision, because all of a sudden your vision is going to be far more expansive than I want an accounting job at another accounting company.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
All of a sudden, when you do the side-by-side comparison from the out of the starting gate here, Philippe, the difference between using innovation best practices and the normal way of approaching it, all of a sudden is a dramatically different picture, and one that gives you far greater promise of success down the road just with this one step. The second step really involves then using in a person who says, okay, I want to find another accounting job. They go to generate ideas about how to do that. Remember, that's step two in the innovation process.
Mm-hmm.
They do. They say, well, okay, I should look on Monster, Career Builder, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so those are the ideas about where I'm going to go looking for an accounting job. And all of that makes sense if that's the path that you're on.
Mm-hmm.
If on the other hand, we now move over to the person using innovation best practices, you say, okay, I now have this expansive vision of success that where I want to be able to utilize my key strengths. You identify the top two or three strengths that in your vision of success that you want to be able to use.
Uh-huh.
And then you get together a mini quantum idea generating session. Here's what you do. You get a group of friends and people who know you with very diverse backgrounds in different kind of jobs, people that you respect for their thinking ability, their creative ability. Second, you bring in a whole bunch of stimulus about the kinds of jobs that might utilize the strengths that you have and the companies that have them. And, you know, if I said earlier, if you go from your objective being an accountant to one being able to utilize your strengths of data, all of a sudden the number of opportunities and job descriptions in companies that need that go up into the hundreds. And now you want to narrow that down pretty quickly, but suffice it to say, the amount of stimulus that you can bring in, job titles within everything from a General Electric and GE and IBM down to the corner grocery store, wherever they are, the kinds of companies that need people that are highly proficient with the strengths you have is going to be very extensive. And so you want to kind of bring that stimulus into the room. So you bring four to six people into a room, you bring stimulus into the room, and here's the most important part. You order pizza, you get beer, you get flip charts, you get ideas.
That sounds like a plan. Let me tell you something. So people can understand that I'm really serious about this. Can people see this? Can you see my iPod there? This is my Kindle.
Yeah.
You see that? What's the book there, ladies and gentlemen? Can you see that there? There it is.
Proven practical innovation that delivers results.
And I have the book too. Let me tell you why, ladies and gentlemen. It is radically important to be, you know, I am a student of my guests. So, you know, people always ask me, well, what makes you such a great interviewer? I'm a student of my guests. The people that I have on my show, I don't just follow them. I learn them. They're my teachers. And there are certain teachers like Richard that are what I call my quantum group of teachers. I mean, these are the cats that, you know, blow your mind, right? So Richard blows my mind. And every time I have a free moment, wherever I'm at, I'm catching a glimpse of this wisdom because, you know, it's a book that, and this is the back cover as well, it's a book that you want to read again and again, and every time you do, it's like adding a layer to the cake, and all of a sudden you end up with this masterpiece, and you start, your cells in your body start to resonate the words and the meanings and the process. Think about what would happen if you applied these principles to finding a new career for yourself. This a new year. You're always complaining, oh, I'm sick and tired of this job. I don't like it. I'm not getting enough money, or I don't have enough time for my kids, or whatever. You can apply these principles to match yourself to what you want in life using these principles. That's amazing. And your resume would just go on fire. This is like a quantum resume. Can you imagine what your new objectives would be? Because now you have taken such a narrow focused resume and core competencies and skills, and now you've quantified them. you have expanded your life to a possibility that you didn't even know existed just using these principles. That's unbelievable to me. Those are mind-blowing things. And you know, we all have read all the books. We watch Oprah. You know, we've done all the Super Soul Sundays and the master classes, and that's good stuff. But sometimes you just need a how. You know, sometimes it's going beyond the hope. You need a how. You need a process. Richard is a strategist. He is a strategy thinker. That's what this is. It is a how-to, step-by-step way to get from here to there. And it's proven. All right, I went on another tangent, but you know I do that from time to time on the show because, you know, these things are important for people to understand, Richard, that, you know, this is not a blowing smoke up your stuff and rah-rah, sis, boom, bah. This is not motivational speaking. You know, when you learn how to use these principles, you're already motivated.
Yeah.
It's natural.
Yeah, I'm sure your listeners appreciate what I already appreciate in you, and that is that you do engage, you do listen, and you do learn, but you also don't know, but you also teach us on the other side of the camera here, too. And that's very important. I view this as a great learning opportunity, and it works both ways here. So my hat's off to you in the way that you go about this, because I think you help your listeners get even more out of this than if it were done by 98% of other people out there. So
thank you for that. So yeah. Go ahead, Richard. I went on a tangent, but you know, let's continue about this.
Yeah.
And how to apply this more in our everyday lives.
Yeah, it's now that you have the ideas, because the pizza and beer were there, the ideas, you want to select two or three ideas, maybe four ideas, about different ways that you could achieve your vision for success. And you just don't want to leave them as ideas on a piece of paper. You want to build them out. Let me take an example that you are an accountant. And one of the job titles that, because you've researched it, the people in your group helped you understand it better, is a data analyst. Well, you're going to find there are data analysts across so many companies, and they are so important to the success of the enterprise. So you say data analyst. Okay, I need to dive deeper and learn what that job is about and the opportunities and all that sort of stuff. And so you develop a learning plan about these new opportunities and where they are and how you access them and how do they talk about them. And people that are in those jobs that maybe have written books, I'm just kind of rambling, but you just kind of want to go all in to kind of learn what it's about. And you want to do that for each of the two or three sort of directions that you think that you want to go in and utilize your core strengths. Now, the person on the other side who's just following it the normal way is not doing any of the deep dive and due diligence that you are. They're just kind of setting up alerts on Monster and Career and stuff, and that's the extent of their work. Let me jump forward to a very, very important part of the process. And before I jump forward, the person using innovation best practices is then going to develop a marketing plan, if you will, to find that data analyst job and other sorts of things. They're going to use a whole bunch of resources between social media and LinkedIn and their personal networks and the personal networks of others, the 6 degrees of separation, all that sort of stuff,
mm-hmm.
to find opportunities. I want to jump forward to sort of the last step in this process, which is the interview process. And as background for your listeners, in my career at Procter & Gamble and Gallo, I have done literally over between 500 and 600 interviews in my career, and from a conservative standpoint. A lot of those were on college campuses all around the country, but they were for senior positions too.
Mm-hmm.
And in the course of that, boy, did I see the interview stinkers out there and people that didn't know how to interview. I want to share with you just as a personal example, in my own case, because I know this well. It's how did I get a job at the premier marketing company in the world, Procter & Gamble? Well, take a look at my credentials. I have an undergraduate degree from Penn State in pre-law. Didn't take a business course in my life. Okay, Procter's not going to be too impressed by that, are they?
Mm-hmm.
I then went to, got accepted to Boston University School of Law. Doesn't have a lot to do with, lawyers are kind of like the, no offense to the lawyers listening to this, but they're kind of the antithesis of sales and marketing, if you will.
Right.
And so you say, okay, well, how did you do that? Well, here's what I did. When I interviewed with the sales organization, I tailored my preparation in the following way. I said, what can I share with them about what I've done that would show my ability to make a really tough, really important sale? And this is the example I gave. At Penn State, a few years before I got there, the Campus Humor magazine had run some little bit off-color articles about the daughter of the president of the university. And he kind of took it personally and kicked the humor magazine off campus. So when I got there, there was no humor magazine. And a friend and I got together and we decided, for some strange reason, that we wanted to bring the humor magazine back. And we went through a process of working with alumni, working with students, working with the president of the university, developing a new charter, a whole bunch of steps that took about 5 months of a school year to get done. But when we got it done, we then opened the doors and the campus turned out to interview for jobs and everything that we had on the Campus Humor magazine. And the end result was that we came forth with the inaugural issue, which showed the jester that was the symbol of the Humor magazine breaking through the student newspaper that had reported the banning of the newspaper. Well, I brought this story into and materials in. I brought the first issue in. I brought news stories into my interviews where I unfolded the story step by step, and they understood several things. One, they understood that it was a very difficult challenge. Trying to convince a president of a major university is not a walk in the park. That I can testify. But I brought visuals that I was able to show people. I was able to bring stories behind those visuals. And Procter & Gamble offered me multiple job offers to work in the company by my ability to bring together a highly persuasive, prepared interview, even though my credentials, if you will look at them from a purely academic standpoint, might not have been there. Now, I'd also been a leader in student organizations and all that sort of stuff, so my leadership credentials were well established also. Here's what I want to suggest. I want to bring this home now for your listeners. Here's what you want to do for an interview. This is kind of like innovation best practices brought to interviewing. Okay, where the rubber meets the road. You're either going to sell it or you're not. Here's how you sell it. The first thing is you start looking at what are the three or four greatest accomplishments that you have that you feel are relevant to the job that you're applying for. And you want to write that out. You want to say, here was the problem, here's what I did, and here's how it turned out. You want specifics, you want clarity, you want succinctness, okay? So when somebody asks you a question, tell me why you want this job, you know, one of those wide open jobs that you can kind of say, well, I like the color of your building. No. You don't want to go there. You want to say, I think there's an opportunity to utilize one of my top skills. That skill is, and let me give you a very specific story of how that illustrates that skill. Here was the problem. Here's the skill I used, and here's how it turned out. If you're prepared with that, as opposed to shooting from the hip, I've been, as I said, 500 or 600 interviews I've been in. When somebody does that with me, I go, wow.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And do the same thing for all of the other ones. You want to be prepared for the interview with what the stories that you want to tell. And you want to be able to do that for virtually any question that they ask you. I once went through interview PR training at Procter & Gamble, and this is not going to be a pretty story. It's kind of like the media training went as follows. Because I had done a number of media interviews on television and radio as a result of marketing of various things. And they said, when somebody asks you a question, you answer it with your talking points. Now, have you listened to any of the presidential debates? You get asked a question and you go, and then they start answering and you go, did you at all hear my question?
Exactly.
You're not answering the question. The point I'm trying to bring into an interview here is, that you want to be prepared with specific examples that you that are all ready to be able to present in their most powerful and succinct version. Here's the other thing you want to do. You want to be a great listener. You say, well, wait a minute, Richard, this is, I'm in an interview, I need to transmit. No, you want to listen. And I'm going to give you one of the biggest things that you need to listen for, one of the biggest things that can help you. Sometimes interviewers don't ask good questions, or they ask good questions in bad ways. And a bad way is, tell me what you did with it. And you go, what the heck is it? And you don't want to sound dumb, so you embark on giving an answer. Well, you went north when they wanted you to go south, but you didn't know what it meant. So here's what you do. Somebody says, what did you do with it? You say, I want to make sure before I answer your question that I truly understand what you're looking for. Are you looking for A? And they'll either say yes or no. And if they say no, then you've got an opportunity to clarify. You don't want to answer a question with a wrong answer that shows you truly didn't understand them. Why? Because interviewers have big egos. They think they spoke entirely clearly and should understand what they're asking for. So just make sure that listening is an important part of the skill that you bring to it. So this is all comes under the category of, for example, when we talk about products and innovative new products, one of the things we talk about are detailed plans to be able to bring it to the marketplace, to be successful. This is about how you are successful, bringing innovation best practices, the sort of preparation, the due diligence, how you bring it to everything from your vision of success to when you walk into that interview and what you are prepared to do.
Well, you know, not to interrupt you, but I think that this is amazing because it's just not limited, in my opinion, to interviewing for a job. I just saw the new model for coaches and consultants. That's what I got. It just was like, it was like a light bulb went off in my head. I was like, OMG. If a coach or a consultant uses these principles to for a client, that client is going to love them. Can you imagine? Because that client that you're going after could be analogous to an interviewer in a traditional job. But the principles are the same. If you went through all of these steps and really listen to what the client is looking for and apply these principles, you would be able to give the best consulting, the best coaching that they have ever seen in life, and make it so personal that they will say, well, where have you been all my life?
Yeah. Oh boy. I'm glad you said that, and you said it very well. You're exactly right. And we could talk a lot about this. Here's my experience with the consulting and coaching field. And I'm an executive coach too, and for numerous presidents of corporations over the time on a very selective basis. And I've got a lot of friends in the business. And a lot of them like to put together very complex systems and processes with highfalutin sort of names that involve 12 to 15 steps and all of that sort of stuff. And it's kind of addressed at things that are important, but not the most important things. And in the spirit of the book title that we've been talking about, I'm kind of like, get down to the core essence of what's critically, critically important. Mm-hmm. And focus on that and do that right. The interview is where the rubber meets the road. Mm-hmm. Okay. People just don't teach it. I taught it in my years as a professor at Arizona State University. I would give my students in the first class an option on two subjects that would be taught in the course out of eight that were optional. And every year, one of them was always, Richard, teach us how to interview. And because they understood that was a core critical skill that if they could do better than other people, with the same credentials, if they could interview better than someone else with the same credentials.
Or even less credentials,
they could probably get the job.
Yep.
Right. So it's kind of like identifying these critical things. So when we talk about the vision of success in finding a job, those aren't words that are typically applied to the job hunting process. Mm-hmm. But honest to goodness, if you don't start with, you know, Stephen Covey talked about your true north. What is your true north? What is your vision of where you want to go? What does success look like? Raise the bar up in the vision for success. Make sure that you're really, really going to invest a lot of effort behind something that when you get it, you determine that's going to really solve the problem or optimize the opportunity for me. So it's kind of like getting the really essential things right. And then there's a lot of executional things that you can do around it. And I got all that. But if you don't get the essential things done and you don't use proven practical tools, your chances for success go down. And what I want to do here is try to help people. There's no guarantee of success in this. There isn't. But what I want you to do is to be able to increase your chances for success. Mm-hmm. Proven practical processes. So that's what this is about.
What I'm also hearing and I like is, and I'm getting, and it's just ringing, buzzing loudly, is these principles, especially as they relate to interviewing or consulting and coaching, is the questions that you ask get to the heart and the core value of the individual who is looking to hire you. And or looking for your skill sets, core competencies to solve a problem. What I like about it, your process of innovation, John Hartman of Axie, who created Axiology, the study of human values. When you get to, a lot of people don't know how to get to that, those questions that get to the core value of what an individual really wants. Because you're so trying to impress people. I have done all of these things. And it's like, well, that's great. But, you know, I want you to solve my problem, my issue. And your process, Richard, gets to the core of that and matches value to value. And that is a very powerful thing. And I think that is one of those hidden nuggets within the simplicity of practical innovation.
Yeah, you're exactly right. I want to give you another briefer example. And that is that somebody has, moving from having a job, somebody says, and this is maybe a New Year's resolution, I want to be happier in 2016.
Mm-hmm.
And they say, boy, yeah, I want to be happier. Boy, that would be, if at the end, 12 months from now, I could be happier, that would be great. And they kind of think of this to themselves, and they say, if I had more money, I could be happier. So they kind of do this all by themselves. And they say, I'm going to go find a career. I'm going to find a job that can give me 20, 30, 40, 50% more than I'm currently making. And at the end of the year, I'm going to be a lot happier. Why? Because we see people with a lot of money. They look happy. Celebrities look happy. Or the whole culture says, if you make more money, you're happier, right? So they say, boy, that sounds right. Let me give you the person on the other side, innovation best practices, because this was actually me at one time.
Mm.
And I said, I'm okay, but I want to be happier. And I said, what does success look like and how do I get there? And that eventually ended me, brought me down a path, which I'll get to in a little bit more in a moment, writing a book about it, because all my books that I've written have been about, I'm curious about something. I was curious about how can you actually be happier? What do we really know about that? Mm-hmm. And here's what happens. If you, instead of just relying on yourself, you then say, I want to create a vision of what success looks like, which is me being a whole lot happier.
Mm-hmm.
And what are the resources and capabilities and paths to do that? And what you're going to find is that the field of positive psychology, Dr. Marty Seligman pioneered it, and I studied with him for 22 weeks, that we know a fair amount. Things like gratitude, serving others, appreciation, love, family, those sorts of things are very important. Looked at from an Eastern perspective, we know even more. Uh-huh. That there are spiritual practices, meditation, study of wisdom traditions, and all the other sorts of things, that when you combine what you know, what the East and West know about happier, you get this great portfolio of opportunities. You know one thing that's not in that portfolio? More money. In fact, Marty Seligman has done the research, and others have since confirmed it, that once you make more than about $35,000 or $40,000, and you ask people how happy they are who make $50,000, $60,000, $75,000, $175,000, $375,000, they're all equally happy. Mm-hmm. Money is not the path to happiness. And there's so much
evidence. Fascinating thing. You're so right. So right.
Right. So the person who defines their objective to be happier, not using innovation best practices, because innovation practices say, okay, before I cross the start line, let me make sure that I really understand am I going to go in the right direction? And when I invest all this time and effort and money maybe to get there, am I actually going to achieve my result? Pause. Use best practices to answer the question. Mm-hmm. For those of you folks that are interested in the topic of happiness, probably one of the most practical, besides proven practical innovation that delivers results, I've got another book out there called Ultimate Happiness, the best of proven, there's that word again, proven Eastern and Western ways to be happier today. And I studied with great Eastern masters like the Tibetan master Sogyal Rinpoche and others, and as I already said, with Dr. Marty Seligman and others from a Western perspective. And in as best I can figure out, it's about the best book you can find on bringing together Eastern and Western. So moving aside from the promotional plug from the book, at the heart of what I want to come back to here is, Philippe, that when you have an important objective, remember, in the very first episode, I defined innovation as action to make something better.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
To get a better job, to be happier. So that's where innovation best practices can help you. So use innovation best practices, start with a vision for success, develop the capabilities and the plans to be able to achieve it. Choose those ideas which are right for you. If you decide that you really want to focus on the Western perspective and a way of doing it, and you want to serve others and help others, and you start working with the American Red Cross or as I did when I started on my path on this, or other organizations and hospice or wherever you want to do that, you're serving and you're going beyond yourself to make contributions to other people and help their lives be better. Just doing this process is going to open up new possibilities. You need to choose the ones that are right for you.
Mm-hmm.
Do it and then invest all the effort. You can have far greater chances for success of achieving your goal of being happier or having a better job or whatever it is when you do this.
I want to go back to that piece though. We were talking about happiness, and this is, you brought up a very profound part, and that is money does not make you happier. Money is the reward once you understand what happiness is. You're rewarded money after you find out who you are. It's not the getting the money is like, well, no, because here's what happens 90% of the time, 99% of the time, you see it on the news, everything. And I've had countless interviews with some of the richest people in the world. If you don't know who you are, money just makes you more of whatever it is you already are.
Yeah.
It polarizes you. So if you are unhappy, unsure, butthole, when you have no money and all of a sudden you get money, you're going to be a insecure butthole with $1 million.
Yeah, and
here's nothing to do with the amount of money that you make.
Yeah, and here's the tragic part. You've now gone down that path. You've got more money, and you wake up and you go, "Oh, darn! This was not the right way to go." You're now trapped. Why? Because you've got a lifestyle and debt and everything around it that you're now you find yourself in a prison.
Extremely good point. Oh my God. Now we can have a whole nother show on this because this is really important. And when you look at all the reality shows, ladies and gentlemen, when you look at all of the people out there that, you know, they have a lot of money, but you can look and tell these are some unhappy, unfulfilled people. Imagine if they used these innovation practices to restructure and reboot their lives, to find out what their true north is, because they didn't know.
Yeah.
And it was like what you said earlier in the show is, I'm paraphrasing, but you know, going after something the wrong way and being successful at it, and then now you're stuck with it.
Yeah.
This is very powerful because it applies to, it can apply to every aspect of your life, and rebooting every aspect of your life and find happiness, true happiness and true fulfillment. Richard, you close out on that, on that piece.
Yeah, it's, I guess the biggest part of advice in the whole innovation process, and we've said it, but it bears repeating. When you want to make something better, or you want to optimize an opportunity that's in front of you, and you're about to embark on doing that, you're going to take action. Remember a couple of things. The most important thing to do is kind of define what success looks like. And then step two, develop a broad, diverse, and deep range of possible ideas to get that done. And what I'm going to tell you is, if you do that all by yourself, your onesie, you are not going to get the big vision of success. You are not going to get all the ideas that are going to be able to get you across the finish line to your vision for success. These two things, if you got to dot I's and cross T's on these first two steps. There's a lot of steps that follow. But if you haven't got this right, then all the rest of those things are going to bring you to the wrong place. Please, 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 vision for success, create, get together a diversity of ideas and possibilities, look at them objectively, make your choices, whatever they are. But you're now making choices from far bigger ideas, far broader ideas and possibilities that can really help you. Do a favor. In 2016, just do these two steps. And even if you are not very proficient in the rest of the steps, your chances for success are almost going to double.
Wow. All right. We have to end it on that, because I don't even know if we could top that. That's amazing. Richard, thank you. Now, here's what we're going to do, ladies and gentlemen. We just have to do it. Richard is going to be coming back, and we're going to kind of do like almost like a microscope show with Richard, where we're just going to flush out various different aspects of innovation as it applies to our everyday life, to our business, but really get deep down and dirty into it. And we've had some broad perspective with this series. We've also gotten some strategies and narrowed some of the focus. But now we're going to apply it to your life and how you can really use these principles, not just use these principles, I shouldn't say use, because it really moves from using to living.
Living, right? Yes.
This is a lifestyle. Proven practical innovation that delivers is a lifestyle practice. And I think that's what I'm going to start calling it for myself, because it's more than a tool. It's more than a tool. It's kind of like saying, hey, I'm going to go in my brain and I'm going to rewrite new code. I'm going to update my operating system that so that when new experiences come into my life, I have the ability to completely embody all of the happiness, wonderful things that life has for me. And that's really what this is. It's a completely new mindset and paradigm shift that writes new code in your brain. So, Richard, thank you so much for this series. And stick around in the green room, but I want to sign off to people watching. Look, go get it right now. Just stop, go get it. Download it, buy it, if whatever apparatus. I put it on all my apparatuses. So I have this book on my phone. I have it on my iTouch, my iPod. I have the book. So I have it in every aspect of my life that I am at. So it is a reminder for me so that it becomes cellular, at the cell level for me. That's what I want you to do, because I want a 2016 that's better than the previous years. And I want a great 2017 and a great 2018. And this is the guy that has come into my life to help me do it. And he's going to do the same for you. Richard, thank you so much for being with me.
My pleasure and honor to be with you.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for watching. Happy New Year. I don't think we're going to be back until the new year. Yay. All right. We'll see you soon next time on the Philippe Matthews Show, wherever you are around the world. Thanks for tuning in.